on G and sorry, on G and A. And here, choice of measure on G and G M. So these two choices cancel, of course, but the choice of the measure on G cancels with the other side. So again, the good way would be to use measures instead of function. It's what really, I didn't do that because it's not the way it's written usually, but when really, if you don't want to have choices of measures, you use measures.
Sorry, so these choices on both stabilized, they will cancel each other.
Yes. You have to use compatible choices, otherwise, of course, it becomes meaningless. So the choices have to be compatible. Okay, so far so good. So you have the test formula. Well, for you, you can, for example, look at particular cases. So maybe I should mention at least two particular cases. Well, the first one, which is the most well known, maybe, is the case of gamma is just 1 and G is compact. Then the geometric side is easy. So it's just f of of 1. There's nothing else. And this is the sum of m gamma m of pi times of pi of f. And this is the Planck-Schrell formula. In that case, one can show that m of pi, the gross dimension of pi, they are all finite dimensional. This is the Planck-Schrell formula for compact rules. Due to Hermann Weyl, or even before, I don't know. This goes back at least to Hermann Weyl. In the theory, we have two Weyl. Hermann Weyl and André Weyl. I make a slight difference in the pronunciation just for me to be able to recognize which is which.
But in Russian, this is the same. It's okay. The problem.
So I try to say it in a very German way. Hermann Weyl. Why I say André Weyl? As if it were a French word, but it is not, of course. It's a word from it's Alsatian, yeah. So it's German, in fact.
the same roots, yeah.
Yes, probably. I'm not sure. I am not sure. This I don't know.
But the Bayern is from the north. You see, she was born near Hamburg.
Yeah. So I must say I don't know exactly what. Okay. So that's the first example. The second example, which is also very well known, is when G is abelian.
gamma co-compact.
Then the press formula is nothing that the Poisson summation formula.
I let you make the exercise to see that it is just Poisson summation formula. For a class of function very regular on G, so it's not the most general form of the phase formula. In any case, I didn't try to prove the most general form of it, but generally the space of smooth compact isoportic functions are dense in any kind of object, and it might be useful sometimes to extend the phase formula to a larger family of functions, but this will not occur in what we do. We are happy with the compactly supported function. Smooth compactly supported function. Okay, so maybe the last example. Which is already a part of our game. Third example. Example is the case of quaternion algebra used in jacket anglante. In this case, the group G is over. Third example, then G is the G of AF. What I have called AG, or something in the center, where G is a multiplicative group of a quaternion algebra. So it's, say, D cross, where D is a division algebra, quaternion algebra. Over some number field, F. Well, then this is fairly general.
AG is the center.
So AG is not exactly the center. Oh, yeah. It's a. I explained that yesterday. I tell you what it is for. For GL, for GL.
Mm-hmm.
So AG, I repeat, AG for GL. Just to make things clear. Mm-hmm. Then you look to say lambda. Mm-hmm. These elements are in the center.
Mm-hmm.
And you consider the lambda in F tensor V, tensor R, sorry. And in fact, F tensor R multiplicative. And you embed R multiplicative by the diagonal embedding for all the places, for each Archimedean places.
Mm-hmm.
And you assume that the lambda belongs to that element.
Mm-hmm.
So the set of all these objects, this is AG.
Oh. Mm-hmm. So it's more than a subgroup.
Yeah, it's a subgroup of the center, which is, even positive. It's mm-hmm. a connected component of a Lie group, of an abelian Lie group, which sits in the center.
Yeah.
And this is enough so that the this is important to mod out by that.
In order that
G over gamma, so if gamma is G over F, now G over gamma is compact. Mm. But if you forget about the AG, this is not true simply, for stupid reasons. But that's the object.
So in this case, the split torus is one-dimensional, right? And so AG is just a star.
So in the case demultiplicative, the same.
It's almost the same as here.
It's isomorphic, so it contains Z multiplicative. It's the same. It's common with GR. It's common with GR. Because this guy is an inner form. It's an inner form of GL, too. But inner twisting don't act on the center. They act trivially on the center. So there is really a canonical isomorphism with ZGL. So that's it. Okay, now I have, I'm a bit behind schedule, but I'm not so sure I should have been faster. Okay, so now I want to discuss the general case. So, general case. What do I mean by general case? Now I go back to that situation. G of AF mod AG and gamma is G of F, so it's general in that
so you can't
in this respect.
You can't see the quaternion now.
No. Where G is any connected reductive group over F. So I restrict to this situation. Or if you prefer G over gamma with gamma and arithmetic subgroup. But things are not written in that in that generality even. So the general case, so we will first discuss, nevertheless, if you want to think at the beginning, think of GL2 or FL2. I will discuss mainly this case, but there are things that can be said in general. So, let's see what happens. So now, in general, the volume of G over gamma is still finite, but G over gamma not compact in general. So what are the consequences of this fact? The consequences, rapidly speaking, is that all what I have explained works down. So to be serious, so you still have L2 of gamma under G. This perfectly makes sense. You still have the C infinity function CC of G of AF. It's not necessary to model out by the AG. This algebra is perfectly nice. The central part acts trivially. So. Okay. But so, the interest of this is that this is a restricted tensor product of local objects. Okay. But so, this acts on L2 of G over gamma. No problem.
So, I have a question. You wrote that G is
yes.
G of Adele is quoted by AG and here.
Ah, I'm sorry.
And so,
so if you prefer,
it's always in G.
If you prefer? You like?
Yes, it's better. Yes.
It's the same. By definition, this is that. Okay? You can put NG on both sides, it is in the center.
It's not compact, let's say.
No, no, in general, it's not compact.
Not compact in general.
It may happen, but it's not always the case.
And then if you connect both spaces, you will connect both spaces.
What do you mean by connect?
One space in the group itself and the other in the quotient.
Yeah, well, you have the group acts on the
just, so you distinguish.
Yeah. The group acts on this.
Okay.
You could write this on like X.
Yes, so want. This is one is representation space.
So this is an algebra, and you have a space, you have the L2 of X. And you have an algebra, say,
yes.
A that acts on the, okay? That's the situation.
And as you used to say, in the case of elliptic curves, it will be compact.
No. The classical case already is not compact.
Ah, SL2, yes. Okay. Please.
So you have a curve.
Okay, yes. And you have to compactify, yeah.
You have to compactify by adding a point.
Okay,
but the point is really missing.
It's because G invariant is not modular form, yeah? Because it's
it's a different. Well, G as a pole, so in fact, but it's not because. What? Yeah, in some sense, because of that, you can say that. Okay. See it as you want, but at least the basic example is non compact.
Ah, basic, not compact.
The basic example is not compact.
Only it's attached.
So, quaternion algebra is a twisted form, is an inner form, then you get a compact case.
But not piece of form, not compact.
Usually, when the G is quasi split, then non compact. Typically, GLN, not compact, SPN, you get a non-compact space. Unitary group, quasi split
unitary group, non-compact,
GLN, you get something non-compact. So the most interesting case are finite volume, but not compact. I mean the space X with which we work. So, that's a serious fact. We cannot avoid, and hence.
I would like to make it more precise. So I guess that you would like to operate this infinity on L2, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but then maybe in L2, what does it mean in L2? Maybe you also assume that the functions are not reconstant with respect in non-Hermitian variables. So.
No.
Because otherwise, how does make it out?
You can always come on.
You.
You have two choices. And speaking of Hilbert space and smooth compactly supported function, you may restrict to K-finite if you want. I don't speak of vector algebra. One has to be careful. You have the Hilbert or unitary Hilbert space and unitary representation situation. On the other hand, you have automorphic forms and representations, right? Never defined, in fact, this up to now, an automorphic representation. And you have vector algebras here. Here you have the space of smooth, compactly supported function of G, or you may restrict if you want to those that are k finite on both sides. But so I have the end of x. Here I have the space of automorphic form A of say D term. Well, I don't say that automorphic form belongs to L2. I'm not working in that generality. It doesn't work. There is one space which is in common. Cusp forms. So cusp forms. They belong to automorphic forms. And they also belong, I said that, I didn't prove it, but I said that they belong to L2 of gamma and G.
Sorry, the automorphic forms are inside this space, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Inside this function, so.
Say automorphic forms for G and F. So I recall that what I said yesterday, automorphic forms are function on a GA, invariant on one side by GF,
nice.
And that are slowly increasing, that
indeed.
Are K-finite, ZG finite, they have strong regularity properties, but for example, they are generally slowly increasing.
Yes, yes.
And they are not square integrable.
Yeah, yeah. So actually, we have on the daily group three beings. So this function is compact surfaces, L2, in a harmonic form.
Absolutely.
Three things.
Yes, that the interplay between all the subjects, which is a noise inspection.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to be. So sometimes people just loosely say that this is a space of.
It is the origin of my question. Yes,
yes. Which is absolutely wrong.
Yeah.
But somehow you can find basically most of the interesting object here.
Mm-hmm.
But it is still really not true. Strictly speaking, it's absolutely wrong. So, for example, even the object that I will discuss that allow to construct the spectral decomposition. You will have a spectral decomposition here. The spectral decomposition, you will have a discrete spectrum. The discrete spectrum will contain the space of cusp forms. Discrete spectrum is larger, and you have a continuous spectrum. The continuous spectrum is constructed out of object called Eisenstein series. Eisenstein series are automorphic forms. But they don't belong to L2. In the same sense as when you work with L2 of R, you have E to the 2 pi I x, or lambda x. This is a function
which is for spectral decomposition.
Which occurs in the spectral decomposition, of course, the Fourier decomposition
uses
that, but these functions are not L2.
Yeah.
That's well known. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's only in the compact case that the function is on. But the plane waves are not square integrable. They don't belong to the space. So it's necessary when you want to have a spectral decomposition. This is really a generalization of that. You have to enlarge the space of functions. And you have to consider automorphic forms more general than the element of L2 of X, even if you want to work with L2 of X.
Mm.
Moreover, you have objects here that definitely are by no means square integrable and don't occur in the spectral decomposition. It's even more general.
Because even in the case of elliptic curves, it's some holomorphic condition, so it's much more general than L2.
Because, for example, Yeah. If you yesterday I introduced G4 and G6. These objects are so called holomorphic Eisenstein series. These holomorphic Eisenstein series are perfectly nice automorphic forms.
Yeah.
They are modular forms, they are automorphic forms. They never occur anywhere in the spectral decomposition. They are absolutely out of the game as regards the spectral decomposition. So you have to keep that in mind.
As in your previous lecture, you explained that automorphic forms with some functions to some finite conditions, yes?
Regularity
but conditions. Any functions, not continuous, not okay.
Hmm?
Any functions, or continuous functions. Continuous functions.
They are analytic even. They are always. Automorphic forms are always analytic. With respect to
analytic, yes.
Yes, they are analytic because they are solution of elliptic differential equation. You have elliptic operators. So so for example, just very strong regularity condition for an automorphic form, I didn't say. If you have F, an automorphic form, so here F is not on the so it's an automorphic form. Then there exists alpha, so I am using the notation of a compactly supported function on the group. F is it's just the notation are shifted. I am quoting the notation of Harish-Chandra. There is an alpha such that F is equal to F convolution by alpha. So you can, it's connected to Dittmann-Aliava theorem, but it's a different form of it. It's very strong. An automorphic form, you can always pull out as many convolutions as you want. Well, because you live by the action of the center of the envelope algebra MK, you live in a finite dimensional space. So it's not too difficult to build. When you look at the convolution operator by alpha, it's a certain operator. But then you're in a finite dimensional space, and it's not too difficult to manage so that there is an eigenvalue of 1. So you can build a function. It's not deep.
It reminds me of the finiteness condition.
Yes, the k-finiteness condition is essential also. Yeah. This is the strong regularity you have. Most so the alpha can be taken k-finite on both sides, of course.
So on non-admitting arguments, this is
trivial.
Yes,
this is trivial. But on the global case, it's non-trivial.
So I just like to make it a bit more precise. So in this L2 of G over gamma,
yeah,
we consider just some square root rule. We are not allowing, we are not requiring that they are locally constant with respect to
there is no regularity condition. It's just the basic L2 of gamma over G.
But still, locally constant functions act on this.
Well, regular functions act on non-regular functions. It's not a problem. And they transform them into regular functions, in fact. They regularize. If you take the convolution of a smooth function and an L2 function, if the convolution product is defined, then the result is smooth. So the operator we look at are smoothing, of course, permanently. They are strongly smoothing, but still. Okay?
Thank you.
So it's true, it's really important to have in mind that we are working with spaces that are related but not definitely not equal. Okay? So what should I erase? I can erase that. Again, what I said, I didn't. that all the previous arguments just break down. The convolution operator R of F is no more trespass. And the integral over the diagonal diverge. But nevertheless, everything breaks down, but everything is almost true still. So one has to find the way to make things work. Although they don't work immediately, they don't work properly immediately. So, what is the way of this? So there are two things. So one is to use truncations. Roughly speaking, truncation mounts to this. You got the fundamental domain, you just cut. That's as stupid as that. Well, but it has to be done in a subtle way in general. But so I remember that the tau, the element is u plus I v, and the v. So here you will write v below, so the tau belongs to here, to the e to the power t, some number t. T will be the truncation parameter. T is a real number here. That's all. Well, so you use truncation.
Sorry, when you truncate, you're speaking about what happens under this line.
Exactly. So now the object I write here is a compact. And what is non-compact is this part. Okay. So this is the vague idea, but it has to be made precise. I mean, to see how such truncation makes sense on functions and geometrically and so on.
But very non-canonical. Because you can shift.
Yeah. You can shift. It will depend on t.
So but will you say something about it?
Yes. Yeah? But let me define. So, one introduced for there is a spectral. The spectral truncation uses an object which is called a truncation object. It's denoted by lambda t. Traditionally, this notation is due to Jim Parson. In fact, I will describe the construction of the construction of the trace formula following the work of Jim Arthur. Jim Arthur has worked for more than 30 years, for almost 40, in the mid-70s on this question. So that's a small part of his work that I will describe. I must say that even for GL2 or SL2, the proof by Selberg was never published.
But also use some truncations problem.
Definitely it's the same proof.
Yeah.
Except it's the same proof as far as we know, since Selberg never published it. But one can recognize elements of, well, and at any rate, the proof, the formula obtained is the same. So it's due to Jim Arthur, but in fact, if one looks carefully, this is implicit. In Langlands paper on Eisenstein series. But Langlands himself claims that he did not recognize it. This is implicit. but implicit also for lambdas. Okay. So what is the, I explain what is the truncation operator for GN2. So you take phi, well, something in some a function. Sufficiently regular, you will see, well, in fact, in L1 log of gamma under G. Here, G is GL2R, and gamma is GL2Z. So I work in the really the classical situation, and not the H.
Locus means really locally in some open locus means really locally in some open set.
F is a function in L1 local.
Locally
integrable.
In some open set.
It's integrable on any reasonable measure. So it's L1 local to a sense of analysis, so locally integrable. Mm-hmm. When you have a compact set, it has to be integrable on any compact set. That's simply that. Some regularity condition to define what I will define. So then you have the so-called you have to be able to define the constant term. Generally in that case it's denoted phi zero instead of phi n. So phi of say of tau is what I have defined the day before, so tau plus u du on r over z. You integrate over a diagonal, over an horizontal. Anyway. The function is periodic of phi tau plus 1 is phi of tau. This is a function of the this space. So you can integrate over by hypothesis, L1 log says that you can compute this thing. You can integrate on any local compact set. Okay? You call this phi 0. And what will be lambda t of phi? Lambda t phi of a point, say tau, will be phi of tau if tau belongs to the region, the compact region. So you don't change the function when you are in the compact region. And it's phi of tau minus phi zero of tau, if tau belongs to the remaining part. The case if it goes to infinity. And you extend, so I describe this for tau only in the fundamental domain. And you extend by invariance to the general space. Mm-hmm. So this is a truncation. So in fact, if observe the following, that if phi is Kasperov, by definition, it means that phi 0 equals 0. Then, lambda t of phi equals phi. Lambda t is just the identity on cos forms. Lambda t is the identity on what I call L2 cusp gamma under G. They are not necessarily automorphic forms. I say cusp, you know, just for this condition, but I don't ask any regularity And the growth condition is simply to be in L2. Mm. So these are the functions of an L2 for which this integral vanishes. This makes sense for almost all V, and this is not a, not a difficulty to see that it makes sense for L2. So L2 cusp is a subspace of L2, a strict subspace. It is G invariant, but and it belongs to the eigenvalue 1 for lambda t. Well, in fact, lambda t, so that's the theorem I will tell you what the theorem is. Even if I don't, I may not give the, or I can give if you want the general formula. I will write for you the general formula, but it's a bit complicated to write. So, what are the properties? I will give the theorem. The theorem, which you are after, but which is valid in general for lambda t, is an orthogonal projector in L2 of gamma of x, gamma of g. It's self-adjoint and idempotent. So it's an orthogonal projection. Lambda t is the identity, as I said, on L2 cast, it preserves the K-spiral spectrum.
I'm very sorry, about the previous. So, in your yesterday lecture, you said that phi 0 of tau in the case of modular, classical modular
yes.
form is always constant. It doesn't depend on tau, yes?
Yes, for, well, for the obvious reason, because when you integrate the, an holomorphic form, you get an holomorphic form. And an holomorphic form which is constant on an horizontal line has to be constant everywhere.
Okay, but in general situation, is, it depends. Yeah?
In general, yeah, it's a function of tau. There is no reason. We are not in the... In the so it's not holomorphic at all. As I said, there is no regularity at all. I look at L2.
Ah,
just L2.
And it is the function. Okay.
Yeah, or L1 to define it. Okay.
So this is not nothing about a space of orthogonal form.
No. No, this is much more general. So,
we can see that L1 is functions up to some zero measure.
Yes, yes.
So this averaging is on it's an integral of zero.
Yeah, well, it means that then if you really want that, then this makes sense for almost all tau. So this will define some object in some empty space. So you forget about this. Places where it's not defined. Okay, it's
no big deal.
Do that for a continuous function and just extend by continuity. You have to show that this defines a closed subspace. So if you prefer an exercise, you look at a function on gamma under G that are smooth and square integral. Show that you can define phi zero, and show that the space of that you have defined, such the space of continuous cusp forms, are defined by the closure is a G invariant subspace, which is just the space of the cusp. So you can make this exercise. This is not difficult.
But in general situation, so this truncation is not given by explicit formula because. In definition of a cusp form, this phi zero as you define in classical case. So, and then when we spoke yesterday about the general situation, you took the analog of this integral about this parabolic subgroups,
yes,
and button subgroups. But it was a lot of integrals, not one.
Yeah, because you have
okay, yes.
many parabolic subgroups. I will give you the definition of lambda t for the
okay.
I will give it. But I just state the theorem in order to tell you what are the strong properties of this object.
And also project in L2 as a representation of G, coming to the direction of G.
No.
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 Oh, yeah.
No. I'm sorry.
Yes, you explained it.
No.
The integral over uniform variable was f on f.
With the regular representation. Because of what? Because the regular representation.
Of course.
If I say the, you can.
5 goes to 5 0 comes with G, but then the.
Of course.
It's not only because it's delicate for it. Depends on some additional parameters.
Yeah, and this parameter is by no means G invariant. So it's really very important. So that's the difficult part of the.
That's really the point.
That's really the point. It's exactly like in theoretical physics when you make so-called regularization for in function.
Yes. Which is quite arbitrary.
Ultraviolet divergences, as you cut them, so you have a cutoff, and the cutoff is not as the SI gauge invariant.
This part destroys the
invariant. Yeah, exactly. This was invariant.
Yeah.
So it's exactly the same.
The same
idea. Exactly the same idea. So, and the third property is that if phi is smooth and is smooth and uniformly slowly increasing, for example, phi is automorphic. Then, is the reason why I have taken L1 not and not condition L2. So. Then, lambda phi.
Uniform slow by increasing, okay?
Hmm?
Slow by increasing, yes? It's written.
Slow what?
What is it? Slow by increasing, yeah?
Slowly.
Slowly.
That's what you were calling yesterday, slow growth.
Yes.
Slow growth.
Slow growth or slowly increasing, then lambda t is phi is rapidly increasing.
Decrease.
Yes. So that's the three properties. 1, 2, 3.
But nothing, you can say nothing about the image of this project.
Well, you know that you have a part from each. Yeah, that's the only place where you know exactly what happens.
Mm-hmm.
But for other representations, for other functions, it's complicated. Mm-hmm. For example, you have a function which is automorphic, very nice,
mm-hmm.
always in this situation, that's a constant function. The constant function, it's a very nice function. It's square integrable since the space is of finite volume. Okay? So this is a perfectly nice function. It is automorphic because it's slowly increasing, it's constant. It's k finite, it has all the nice properties, it's smooth and everything. When you truncate it, precisely, what do you do? You say it's 1 here, 0 here. So it transforms the constant function into a heavy side function. So, well, in particular, it destroys smoothness. In particular. Or you could make a smooth truncation by integrating in T if you want. That would be possible, it's not a big deal. But then it would not be a projector, so you cannot have everything at for the same part. So for example, just the trivial representation, the constant, is not preserved by the truncation.
But usually constant functions.
They are very tricky things. Yes. So, typically, the trivial representation occurs in the discrete spectrum, but is not cascading. Mm-hmm. This shows you already that you have discrete objects that don't come from cascading, that are not cascading. But there are also unfortunately, I think I can set up and go much farther today.
Small question. So, slowly increasing means that not faster than every polynomial, yes?
It's some polynomial is a coefficient of the group.
It's rapidly not so by exponent of minus. So.
No, rapidly decreasing, it's less than any inverse of polynomial. I don't claim it's exponentially decaying. But it is rapidly decreasing, in particular, it's
M2. Exponential growth is not slowly decreasing.
So just to finish, I will write you the general form of the truncation. Just look to let you see exactly what it is. You will see the formula is not difficult but a bit complicated. So I will define it for you. It will take another.
Sorry, before it was only about spectral truncation, yes?
Yeah, I didn't discuss the geometric truncation. Let me say simply that using the spectral truncation, one can define the spectral side of the trace formula. Using a geometric truncation, you can define the geometric side of the trace formula. So you make the integral converge by cutting in some way. And then you have to prove that both sides are equal. Makes sense as I go. So let me copy just the formula because I prefer not to make too many mistakes. So lambda of t. So now it's a general case. As you will see, the general case. So I mean general G. So this will be the sum of our all parabolic subgroup between G and P0, you choose a minimal parabolic subgroup. So this whole standard parabolic, say for example, a pair diagonal by blocks for GLN. So this is an alternating sum, minus 1 to the dimension of AG, or I prefer, I call this AG, AP minus AG. I will explain. So you have a truncation object, which is somewhat the most complicated. Oh, I'm sorry, there is again a sum for the psi. They are in the G of F, not P of F.
Just AP and AG will explain. What? AP and
Yes, I will explain. These are just numbers, but it's just dimensions. of tau hat P of, it's a bit complicated, x0 of xi x minus t. And now phi p of xi x. I guess that's it. Yes. So that's the general formula. It looks very complicated, so AP
is the same of A M is the dimension of what I call R M.
So
the A G is the dimension of A G. The M, the P is M N. So M is a reductive group. There is an A M defined, like in G. So you have you have this. So you have the constant term, so-called constant term, which is not constant. That's the tradition you call it the constant term along P. You have the sum over these guys to make it to build something G invariant, it's the G of F invariant. Because when you take the constant term, you destroy the G of F invariant, but you restore it. So now we managed to explain what is the tau P. So the tau P is the generalization of the function which is one, which is zero below T and one above T. This is the generalization of the so for GN2, the this is that. This is the Heaviside function at T.
So, can you compare this structure with this?
Yes, yes, of course.
Yeah, okay.
So now, in general, I will draw a picture for...
It won't be only one term, yes? Yes.
Two terms.
For the left, we will eat lambda t phi at x, right?
I forgot to say at x, sorry.
Yeah.
You're right. I'm sorry. So, I will draw a picture.
H not? H.
So, this is long to explain. So, let me first. Just say. So I will consider the case of GL3. So you have a space which is the algebra of AM.
So you think that the key is of L2 is quite obvious? You think that the key is of G2 is quite obvious?
No. I will come back. But I just want to show you the general case, at least to have an idea of the general case for. So M0, P0 is a minimal parabolic in GL3. Okay? So I have a space AM, which is of dimension 3. That's the algebra of big RM. I have an AG, which is dimension 1. So the quotient AM mod AG is dimension 2. That's the reason why I can make a picture.
P is P0.
P is a minimal parabolic in GL3. Minimum. Here. Okay? Now I can draw the roots. So you have three roots, alpha, beta, alpha plus beta. They live in the dual of, but I identify with the dual of the vector space. And now what is that? So you have you have the right chamber which is like that. And you have the dual, you have to look at the dual cone. It's a bit, I am a bit, sorry. Yeah. And
I guess I have the orthogonal of this and is that true or not? Well, no, in that case it's supported by, yeah, it is. Because they are orthogonal to them. Okay. So the tau hat is a characteristic function of this set. Tau hat P0 is a characteristic function of that cone. It's an open cone. It's a dual cone to the Weyl chamber. Because if, when there is a combinatorics, there is also the tau P0. The tau P0 is a characteristic function of the Weyl chamber. And this is for the dual cone. So you take the orthogonal of the walls, and hence must be in that case given by the roots. But it's a special case.
Sorry, I didn't understand. So T capital is a number. T capital is a number, right?
Yes, it's T hat is the characteristic function of some open set in a vector space.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but your argument, you subtract a number. So what that is.
So altogether, I will subtract the number because I evaluate this on an element in the vector space.
How can I subtract the number from that?
You have a characteristic function and you evaluate it at some point.
Yeah, but so H0 of Xx is a point in the space.
This is a point in the space. This belongs to Am mod H.
But T capital is a number.
Hmm?
But T capital is a number. But T capital is not a number.
What?
T capital is a number.
T capital. No,
it's a point in the vector space.
That's the wrong case.
So now the parameter is not a number.
For a Hong-Kong situation, the vector, so you identify the line with the numbers. But in general, it's a vector. It's a point in the vector space. So generally, the point T is somewhere here.
So the parameter of truncation
lives in the Lie algebra of the A M0.
No, it's not a number.
No, it's no more a number. It's a point. It's a vector.
Can
you
repeat again?
So the T lives in A M0. A, what I call A0. A M0.
Where
M0 is a fixed minimal Levy. So you have to choose the minimal, you have chosen a P0, and you choose a M0. So the truncation depends on many choices. It depends on P, but it depends even on the choices of the P0 and the M0. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of choices. But that's life. Okay. So T is a vector.
That's a part.
Okay. And what is H0 of C?
But AM small? AM0 contains AM. Not obvious, right?
Well, you can. In fact, you have essentially canonical decomposition at some.
So we project on how
you, you project or you take orthogonal complements and so on.
Wow.
You have to be slightly careful because there is no inverse structure, Euclidean structure on AG. But on the rest, on EM0 mod AG, you have a glimpse of that. So you have, and you can choose any structure if you want. But there are some natural decompositions. But okay, it takes hours just to describe.
No, it's okay.
So now, just to finish, I have to describe what is H0. So, the H0, and I have to make the exercise with the GLP. So the H0 is attached to the Iwasawa decomposition. So the Iwasawa decomposition tells you that G, it can be written as
N0, and K. That's the Iwasawa decomposition. Iwasawa decomposition. Okay? So NAX can be written N, M, K. Now you remember, maybe, as I said, we have a map, a natural map, from a group M of A into A M. Now you have your M, and this is S0 of M. The definition of H0, of F, so the M, the X, gives you the M. You take the Iwasawa decomposition. It's not really unique. It's unique up to a factor in K. But the map here is insensitive to compact thing. As you observe, this is trivial on compact subgroups. So the M, which is not well-defined, has a well-defined image in AM.
But sorry, it seems for me that AM is more close to the Lie-algebra. Right?
Yes, it's the Lie-algebra. So you take the logarithm of the
exponential.
Yeah, if for GLN, for example, the AG is just the logarithm of the determinant. The absolute value, the logarithm of the absolute value of the determinant. So for the case of Lewis group in GLN, it's a product of GLN group. So you have all components, and each component is a coordinate of the thing. And the H0 is now here. So the X defines the M by the Iwasawa decomposition up to an ambiguity in K. But this ambiguity has no effect on the image in AM. So this is what, so the composition is well defined. Now this defines you H0 of X. So now just to make the exercise finish, I make the exercise for GL2. For GL2, AG is R, M0 is the diagonal matrices is GL1 for GL1. So AM0 or A0 is isomorphic to R2. The quotient is isomorphic to R, and the T is just a number. That's what it is.
And again here we do not count G, right? We think.
No. Because then lambda T phi is equals to, first you take P equals G.
Ah, we do take.
So you take phi.
Yes, sorry.
Minus, since now you have the first term is P equals G, so it's 0. Minus 1 to the 0, so it's a plus. The second term is... so it's either phi 0 or 0, and it depends on the truncation. According to the truncation. So it's exactly the formula I have given when I am in the fundamental domain. And if I want to restore the invariance, as I said, I extend the function by invariance, then for this you have to take into account the sum.
Yeah, but sir, it's still not an argument of this truncation function. Hmm? It's in this quotient, AM bar AG,
yes? Yes.
So in J2 it will be something one-dimensional. Exactly. Well,
for GL, it's 1 degree Kelvin, yes.
Where this integral.
Yes, yes, it's exactly that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's exactly that.
So, but sorry, still you define this H0 as a function on this AM, not on the coefficient.
Well, but in the classical language, it's easy to see what is H0. Mm-hmm. So, in the classical language, mm-hmm. so you have your element set out here.
Ah, it's because the center,
IP,
center exteriorly.
And, yeah. And, so, the tau is G times E, or X times
yeah, right.
Yeah, okay? So H0 of the absolute value of V, or V, but wait, it's positive.
No, I see, because the center acts trivially.
Yes, yes. It's the logarithm of V when you are in the real part. Mm-hmm. So it's just that.
Yeah.
You take the log.
Mm-hmm.
It's because the U plus IV is attached to the Ivazova decomposition. Because if you have the matrix V, U, 0, 1 applied to I,
mm-hmm.
this is precisely U plus IV. And this is k-invariant, since I is a fixed point under the circle. Under the action of the circle. So you just get the Ivazova decomposition. The traditional image is the Ivazova decomposition for the writing of an element that way. It's nothing but the Ivazova decomposition.
More visible in the Guinness disk, yes?
Yeah, well, depends on you. I prefer this picture, but some prefer the unit disk. But to see it as the Ivazova decomposition is simpler here. It's really direct. So you really see that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So now this gives you the exercises done. So I think I'm going to stop here.
Okay.
Thank you very much.